very pleased to have you here, and I am thrilled to be able to this morning introduce you to someone who is truly an outstanding American. It is my pleasure to introduce today's commencement speaker. Major General John L. Borling retired from the United States Air Force after 37 years of military service. A highly decorated officer and fighter pilot, he graduated from the Air Force Academy, the National War College, and executive programs at the John F. Kennedy School of Government and the Business School at Harvard University. General Borling was a White House Fellow, and his service to his country spanned the globe in several high command positions. On June 1st of 1966, General Borling was shot down during his 97th mission over Vietnam. He was captured and held for 6.5 years as a prisoner of war at the notorious Hanoi Hilton, a site used by the North Vietnamese Army to house, torture, and interrogate captured servicemen, mostly American pilots shot down during bombing raids. The aim of the torture experienced by prisoners was to break their will, both individually and as a group. In 2013, General Borling published a book of poems titled Taps on the Walls, Poems from the Hanoi Hilton. He composed these poems without a pencil and paper, and he memorized them. The book title, Taps on the Walls, comes from how General Borling wrote his poems. He and his fellow prisoners of war developed an alphabetic code that they tapped on the walls to one another as a way of sharing information and keeping their spirits high. If you close your eyes for a moment and you think about what General Borling and his fellow prisoners experienced and their creativity and tenacity to keep their spirits intact in the face of tremendous atrocity, you will come to admire General Borling in the same way that I do. This is one tenacious and truly awesome man. Currently, General Borling is a director and chairman of the business board for Synthonics, a specialty pharmaceutical company based in Virginia, as well as founder and chair of SOS, which stands for Service Over Self America, a patriotic organization that advocates military service for young men ages 18 to 26. His current civic activities include life member of the Commercial Club of Chicago, trustee and regent of the Lincoln Academy of Illinois, president of the Sister Lakes Michigan Land Conservancy, Illinois Aviation Hall of Fame, Who's Who in America, and numerous other local and national organizations. General Borling is married to his high school sweetheart, Myrna. They're the parents of two daughters and live in Rockford, Illinois. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Major General John Borling.
Pride of Superior Men and put it in the kitchen. my wife of 52 years, Myrna, when she saw it in the morning, she would be suitably impressed. And when she came down, she saw it. You know that serrated knife you used to chop the heart bread with? That sign was reduced to rubble. Consigned to the outer darkness, I got bigger there. I never knew my wife was so biased against Algonquin Indians. My bias today is to not deliver one of those shipwrecked commencement addresses. Right? That the highways and byways of universities are littered with. So I'm going to ask for significant audience reaction from what we'll call eighth line over here, Reva and her gang. The always follow orders faculty of the folks sitting behind them will be beef line. Enthusiasm, right? I've got this, the leader of the speech department who's grading me on this thing tonight. This is very intimidating. Okay, you'll be C flight over here, the 2015 graduates, and over here is D flight, the dog flight, bringing up the enthusiasm factor. The name is Borling, not Boring. Okay, I've been introduced as not a landscape from the Air Force for General Boring, but I mean to say not guilty of two counts. Okay, well look, my bias today is to make this special for all of you, for the families who've come to honor, and certainly for the faculty and the graduates and the leadership of FIFA, this wonderful university now headed by President Keith and with the great chair of the Board of Trustees. I come back to North Carolina because I've had a long association with FIFA. I was never fortunate to go here or matriculate here, but I've had a special friend, Keith Crisco, who's no stranger to you all here, now passed, and rightfully we were White House fellow colleagues. His wife, Jane, is here, a special, special friend. So as I say, I keep coming back to wanting to make this special. Is that okay? For example, I had my hair cut for the occasion. I think my stylist was a bit enthusiastic down the middle, but that's all right. In truth, I just want to be genuine. Authenticity really counts. I leave a piece of my soul up here, if I can, in a few minutes, that I'm privileged to offer some thoughts. President Keith focused, I think, too much on the Vietnam experience. His life brings punishment and reward to us all. You just keep picking them up and laying them down. But I will start there. It's August. And I'm being tortured. Again. Now, it's many years ago, long ago and far away, but I make it in the present tense. Not for my personal relevance, but for yours. Because in the course of that session, I was able to get out of the constricting cuffs and the ropes, and I couldn't get out of the shackles, but was able to crawdad my way over to a table. This was 1970. And inside that desk were letters. And I got to start to go through those letters. I didn't know if my family knew I was alive. This was 4 years after our shut down. By the way, I can comment that when I did get shot down, I broke my back in the process. I was way deep north in North Vietnam. Couldn't get out by traditional means. There was no risk. So I decided I would hijack a truck. Sound like a good idea? D-Flight, is that a good idea? D-Flight, did it work out? I decided I'd hijack a truck because I couldn't walk, so I crawled down to the staff and out in the middle of the road and hijacked a truck. Regular troops. And then started that 6.5 years, if you will. But now it's 4 years out, and I'm over at the desk, and I'm getting letters out of that desk. I don't see any for me. There is one for a guy who's about 5 cells down. We were in isolation or semi-isolation most of the time, and we would tap on the wall. So I ripped that letter out and read it real quick. I knew they would be back on me in a second. It was from his wife. Divorcing him, and he never found a never told him about that. I've never mentioned his name. But as they came in now, and they saw that I was over at this desk, and they went crazy. And just before they started working me over again, they were ripping these letters and envelopes out of my hand. And I saw a stamp. Stamp on the envelope. What was the stamp? A man on the moon. This is 1970. When did we go to the moon? 1969, right. So this is a year later. And when I got back into circulation after about another 10 days, by the way, they were torturing us to see who would break first so we could go visit a delegation and tell them how good we were being treated. Man's inhumanity to man. In any event, I didn't see the delegation, but it took about 10 days for me to get back in shape. I tapped on the wall, "We own the moon." And the reason this is personally relevant is today you guys own the moon, right? You are shining in your own firm. At this point, I have Frank Sinatra to come out and do the song, but he's a little busy these days. So I want to talk a little bit about that. Three quick things. When Lyndon Johnson hired out in his first job as a school teacher in suburban Texas, if there is such a thing, all of Texas is suburban, little town, San Carlos, or San Marcos in Texas, the school board, the school leadership, asked him, "Lyndon, you be holding that the world is flat, or be it round?" Lyndon Johnson responded, "I can learn it either way." Never the politician. Well, there's a thing I'd like to suggest in terms of foot stopping something as you keep learning and earning the moon. There are two periodicals that must be part of any educated person's life. To give yourself a worldview, to give yourself insights into the great movements of the human condition. And so the footstopper is, without any other introduction other than I get a dollar subscription when you do it, that's not true. I urge you guys to subscribe to The Economist and to the Financial Times. Those two world newspapers will continue to provide you the learning that will enable you to continue on this wonderful journey that has, in some cases, just commenced today at the undergraduate level, and for the majority of you, at the graduate level. But we all need to keep learning. Fair enough? The second subject that I'm going to talk about has to do with virtues, individual virtues of life. And there are, frankly, the Greeks thought there were only four, but what do the Greeks know? The four virtues of a good person or a good nation or a good citizen, basically, is that you ought to have a sense of justice, a sense of fairness. Does that make sense? Everybody think fairness is a good virtue?
Yes.
You ought to have a sense of temperance or restraint in your own life. We are beset by challenges. Some of the standard vices, you know, the booze, drugs, and sex, and you talk to your teenagers or your younger kids and all the way through life, frankly, temperance. Being able to restrain yourself, being able to put off a present good for a future better is very much part of that virtue of leadership, individual as well as collective leadership. I would suggest to you that I like to jog in the mornings, and that's when I do my devotions. After I'm stretching and doing all that, I always pray for one thing, it's just wisdom, seeking wisdom. That was the third great thing the Greeks taught, seeking wisdom. Makes sense. And the fourth thing is courage. But it's not the courage that comes from battlefield courage, it's the courage to do the right thing in life. That is so. That is so. And you will hit those forks in the road, and the courage to do the right thing will come crashing down behind you. God help you, you will make wrong choices. Leads to failure, and then you got to pick yourself up, lift yourself off, and go on down the road. So those are the four things the Greeks talked about: justice, courage, temperance, and wisdom. I've added four, and I added two of them while I was in prison and two afterwards. I think you need to have a faith-based relationship. I don't particularly care what it is, but you've got to have that knot and rope to hang on to when times are bad and when times are good, particularly when times are good. I think you have to have a sense of humor. I think you have to look at life as kind of an endless, wondrous place where lots of things are funny. In North Vietnam, for example, we had optimists and pessimists. The pessimists thought we were going to die out there, and they wouldn't even send our bodies home. The optimists, on the other hand, were sure they'd send our bodies home. That's crazy. That's an original. That's in the book, by the way. So that sense of humor is important. And then the essence of the human condition. Oh, this is a big one. Put down, write it down, put it in your PDA. The essence of the human condition is the ability to create. To create. It doesn't have to be the arts necessarily. You can create by working with a soccer team or Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts, but in the main, I do mean it is a sense and a love of and appreciation of beauty. Be it dance, be it poetry, be it literature, be it music. Expose yourself to all of that. I do apologize in my book because I say a couple of these things written in my mind back in the 60s. I may have created rap, and I have to always publicly apologize for that. Okay, but that's the essence of the human condition, the ability to create. It kept me alive. Kept me competitive. Do the same to you. And the last one, you're all going to go on, especially at the graduate level. You've been in the business world, your various disciplines, but you are going to be running organizations, some small, some large. It works in academia as well, and you ask yourself, how can I do this? And this is the principle. The principle is you've got to love. You've got to open yourself up. You're going to get damaged in the process, but I've never figured out how to run organizations where I haven't loved how I love. Make sense? So the last four are faith-based relationship, have a sense of humor, for God's sake. Create. Don't be afraid to try to create your own life and those around you, and then be able to love however mean that's going to be as you go along the way. Okay, the last subject, and it's going to take about 2 seconds, about 20 seconds to do it. Are you ready to join the club?
Yeah.
How about D-Flight? Ready to join the club? A-Flight, ready to join the club? Congratulations, go get it.